Hello, options traders, and welcome to another Facebook trading tutorial. And today I want to talk a little bit about synthetic options. We had a very good conversation going on earlier in the week from one of our newest members, Sanjay, who gave a very nice list of various synthetic positions. And I've had a number of people asking and emailing and saying, what in the world is a synthetic option? And where is he getting these various relationships? Well, it's actually fairly easy. I'm going to step you through a formula that you can use to figure out these relationships. And once you become a little more practiced with them, they'll just roll off the top of your head instantly. But when you're first starting, it helps to have this formula to figure them out. But first of all, synthetic options are mathematical relationships that greatly help options traders figure out perhaps which side of the trade do we want to be on. Do I want to take the call side or do I want to do it synthetically through the puts? And I can become more cash efficient. I can find little discrepancies that can give me an edge. Synthetic positions will also help me with what are called morphs. Maybe I'd like to go from the bullish side to the bearish side and I need to change or morph my position into a bearish outlook. And I need to know my synthetics for that. So let's take a look at synthetic options. Where these are coming from, these relationships, is a formula that is called the put-call parity formula. And I know that's a mouthful, but parity is just a word that's used a lot in finance and economics that just means equivalence. And what this formula is going to show is that calls are puts and puts are calls. It just depends on how we hedge them. They are actually equal. And so the put-call parity formula actually looks like this in a simple form. And it says that the stock plus a long put, that's what that plus P is, plus a short call, that's what that minus C is, equals the present value of the exercise price. The present value of the exercise price you can think of as today's value of this package, and that'll make more sense as we go through this. But right now I just want to show you this formula because this is what we're going to derive. I want to show you where it's coming from. And the best way to do that, probably the easiest way to intuitively understand it, is let's take a look at a transaction. Let's assume that you wish to buy 10 one-year $50 calls. In reality, it doesn't really matter what the expiration is, but I'm going to use 1 year just to make the math a little easier. Well, the question we're trying to solve, and don't forget this, the question we're trying to come up with here is, what are these call options worth? Well, let's take a look at the transactions. The market maker must sell 10 of these $50 calls to complete the order, right? You're buying 10, he has to take the sell side. He has no choice. Well, what's his risk? Think about it. He is selling these call options. It's what's called a naked position. And in doing so, his profit and loss diagram looks like this. And you can see that right here is our 50 strike, right? That's where the bend is. And as long as the stock stays at this level or below, falls anywhere here to the left, the market maker is going to make a limited profit. And that is just limited to the credit that he initially received. However, if the stock goes off in this direction to the right, becomes bullish, he has unlimited upside risk. And because there's no limit on how high a stock's price can go, this is a very dangerous position. So he'd obviously like to get rid of this upside risk. How can he do that? Well, he needs to hedge or somehow guard against this upside risk. And so to counter it, the market maker might decide to buy 1,000 shares of stock at 50. Why would that protect him? Because if he has a short call, a naked call, he has the obligation to deliver shares of stock, and we don't know what that future price is going to be. But if he buys the shares today, he knows what his price is. It's almost like taking them in inventory and sticking them on a shelf and saying, I don't care how high that stock price is in 1 year, I've got the price locked up here at its current price of 50. So he can guard against that upside risk. However, it's not going to be cheap. It's going to cost him $50,000, right? 10 contracts that you're trying to buy. He has to therefore buy 1,000 shares for the current price of 50. So he's got to shell out another 50 grand here to start to complete this order. But that doesn't come for nothing. What's his new risk? He's long shares of stock and now short this call that he sold to you. His new risk is going to look like this. The combination of long stock plus a short call, many of you will recognize as a covered call. And this is what the risk profile looks like. In this case, we can see that the $50 strike is still right here at this bend. The market maker will make a limited profit if the stock price rises, but will head into unlimited losses if the stock price falls. It's exactly the opposite of what he had before. Well, obviously he'd like to get rid of this major risk. How can he do that? To hedge this downside risk, the market maker may decide to buy the $50 puts because a put gives you the right to sell shares. So if the stock price starts heading down and he's getting in trouble here, he always has the right to put those shares off to somebody else for $50. Put options act like an insurance policy. He's guaranteed to always be able to receive at least $50, assuming he has the $50 strike. So for right now, understand that the calls and puts must be the same strike, at least for the formula that we're trying to create here. So if he has the January 50 calls, he needs the January 50 puts. And when he does this, the market maker ends up with three different positions. He's got long stock over here on the left. He is long the $50 puts, and he's short the $50 calls. Those are the calls that he sold to you. You're the long position, he's the short position. And this three-sided position has a very special name in options trading. It's called a conversion. And it's used a lot for, among many things, just to figuring out synthetic positions. The opposite of a conversion is a reversal, or sometimes called a reverse conversion. But these are important relationships in options trading. So let's recap the conversion. Remember, it's long stock here at 50. We've got long $50 puts, and we have got short $50 calls. That is always our conversion. Long stock, long put, short call. But what's interesting about this is that this combination results in a guaranteed sale of stock for the strike price or the exercise price. In this example, 50. So because we're dealing with 10 contracts or 1,000 shares worth, and we're guaranteed to be able to sell for that strike of 50, this package is really a disguised package of a guaranteed sale of stock for $50,000. So you can think of it like a bank CD or treasury bill. We're going to pay one price for it today, and 1 year from now, it's going to bring us $50,000 cash, no matter what happens to the stock's price. Now, here's why. Let's first assume that the stock price is trading for exactly $50 at expiration. The put and the call expire worthless, and so the market maker can just sell his shares in the open market. He's got 1,000 shares, current price is 50, and he's got $50,000. So far, so good. What happens if the stock price goes up? Let's say perhaps the stock is trading for 60. In that case, the long puts go out worthless, but his short call is now in the money. And he's going to get assigned on that. The long position will exercise it for those shares. So he's going to get assigned, and that means he will receive the $50 strike. He has to deliver his shares right here. So those are going to end up going out of his account, and in exchange, he'll end up with $50,000 cash, exactly the same as if the stock price went nowhere. What happens if the stock price goes down? Let's say the stock takes a big drop, trading maybe at $40. Now the call option goes out worthless, but he's long the $50 put. He can exercise that put and collect $50. But when he exercises the put, he has to sell his shares. So those are going to go out of the account. And again, he'll collect this $50 strike. So there, again, he will get his $50,000 cash. So once again, no matter what happens, stock stays the same, goes up or goes down, he's going to get $50,000 cash in 1 year. Well, knowing that, how should the market maker price this $50 call? Remember, that was the question that we first posed. What is this call option worth? Well, let's assume that he pays $2 for the $50 puts. Doesn't really matter what price he pays, but he has to pay something. So we could make up any number. We're still going to come up with our put-call parity formula. So I'm just going to pick a number and say it's 2. In this case, he has paid $50,000 for the stock, he's paid $2,000 for the 10 puts, and now we're left with the final puzzle piece here. What are these $50 calls worth? Well, let's take a look at it. He spent $52,000 so far, but what else did we figure out? We know that the package guarantees that he will receive $50,000 in 1 year. Well, if interest rates are 5%, doesn't matter what the interest rate is, but just pick something, then the package today has to be worth $47,619. That's what's called the present value of the exercise price. And that's this PV of X term that we saw earlier in the presentation. Really what it means is that if you're going to receive $50,000 in a year from now, it's not worth $50,000 today. It's got to be worth less. Why? Because you could take that cash and invest it and end up with more in the future. So if I have $47,619 and I invest it at 5%, I will in fact end up with $50,000 in 1 year. So this three-sided position here, this conversion, acts like a discount bond or a T-bill or a bank CD. We're going to pay one price and we're guaranteed to get something, a bigger price in the future. So once again, if I take the $47,619, I multiply it by 1 plus my interest rate or 1.05, guaranteed to get $50,000 in 1 year. Well, that's an important insight. If the market maker has spent $52,000, but we just figured out that the entire package, this conversion, is worth only $47,619, what does that tell you? It tells you that he is overpaid by the difference of $4,381. Well, that's not a good deal to overpay for something. So he needs to make up this difference by selling those 10 calls to you for $4.38. And if he does so, it's going to bring in $4,380 roughly there in cash. So let's take a look at the market maker's transactions. We know he spent $50,000 for the stock. He spent $2,000 for the put. He's going to receive $4,381 from those short calls, which means that his total cash outlay is $47,619, exactly what it should be. And once again, that is the present value of that $50 strike, or the present value of the exercise price. We could also think of it as a bond, as a T-bill. So we've just calculated that this call should be worth $4.38. It's a very roundabout way of doing it, but what would the Black-Scholes pricing model say about this same situation? Over on the left-hand side, we've got a stock and a strike at 50, 360 days to expiration, 5% interest rates, and I've chosen this rather odd-sounding volatility number of 15.76. And I did that because over here on the right, that is the volatility necessary to make the put's price exactly $2. And if you remember in the presentation, I said, I'm just making up a number, let's pretend that the put's trading for two. So in order to create that $2 price, I need to use a volatility of 15.76%. But notice what it's telling me the call option is worth. Look at this, $4.38, exactly what we figured out. So the put call parity formula simply says long stock plus long put plus a short call equals the present value of the exercise price, or more simply, we might just call it a T-bill. If you know this formula right here, you can figure out all of your synthetics. So for example, what is a synthetic call? And to make it even easier, most of the time you're not going to need the treasury bill portion. There are some times when we would like to take a look at that. But for most of your basic synthetics, you don't even need to know that. So let's just think of it like the combination of stock plus put plus a short call equals zero risk. This is the simplest formula that you need, and here's how it works. Let's say we're trying to figure out what is a synthetic long call. Well, a long call needs to have a plus sign in front of it. We need a plus C. Well, I've got a minus C right here. How can I get a plus C? I need to get a plus C by itself. Well, you probably remember from basic algebra, if I add C to both sides, these are going to cancel, and I get a plus C over here to the right. And that tells me that the combination of stock plus put over here on the left is exactly the same as over here on the right, a long call. So somebody who owns the combination of stock plus put is doing exactly the same thing as somebody who owns a call. So right off the bat, we're seeing an interesting relationship here, because most people will tell you that a call option is risky. And they might even say, you know what, you're better off sticking with good old safe stock. If you want to use options, maybe grab some put options for insurance. Now you've got insured shares of stock. That's what this is over here. That's insured shares of stock. Well, guess what? That's exactly what call option traders are doing. They are trading insured shares of stock. The difference is we're not paying for the stock's price today. We are floating that through the expiration date, and that's where we're getting our mathematical leverage and becoming more cash efficient. But by looking at this relationship, you can see that a call option is nothing but insured shares of stock. Let me also show you an easier way to look at this. Rather than going through and trying to add and subtract things to both sides, just take a look at these as if they're individual puzzle pieces laying on a table. And I can just put my finger on them and shuffle them around as I want. I'm trying to get a plus C by itself. Well, let's grab this piece and swing it over to this side. And when I do, every time I change to the different side of the equals, I need to change the sign. But what does it really mean when I say that the combination of stock plus put is exactly the same as a long call? Here's what it means. If we take a look at a profit and loss diagram for our long call up on top, and we compare it to the combination of long stock plus a long put, what do you notice? They are exactly the same. That's what it means to be synthetically equivalent. The long call is exactly the same thing as long stock plus a long put in every respect. Pick any stock price at any moment in time, and they will produce exactly the same profit and losses, and they will produce exactly the same Greeks. So then you have to say, well, why should I pay for the stock and pay for the put, a very expensive combination, even though it's insured stock, when I can do exactly the same thing by buying the call? So for all of you who are new traders out there and find that you're struggling trying to make use of this cash to even go out and buy 100 shares of stock, or even 50 shares for that matter, we can do it quite easily in the options market. But it helps to understand that it's nothing but insured shares of stock. So I'll leave it for the group here to try to solve these on your own. Try to figure out what long stock is synthetically, what's short stock, what's a long put, long call, and short call. And you can do so just by looking at this formula. So let's go through one more. Let's say we try to figure out what is a long stock position. Well, I've already got long stock over here, but unfortunately, I don't have it by itself. I need to get this P and the C over to the other side. So if I swing this C over, that becomes a positive C. And if I swing the P over, that becomes a minus P. So somebody who buys a call and sells a put, same strikes, is doing exactly the same thing as somebody who is buying shares of stock. The difference is if you're buying the stock for 100, you might be able to do this position for almost nothing. You will have a margin requirement, which will probably cost you about 25% of the underlying stock. However, certainly beats Reg T at 50% and certainly beats the stock at 100%. So I hope that helps everyone understand what a synthetic option is. Please post any questions that you may have. And for those who'd like to learn more about the art and science of options trading, please visit optionsaToz.com and check out the Alpha Trader course.